The views expressed and opinions given by the individual hosts and their guests do not necessarily reflect those of ZTalk Radio, its affiliates, or sponsors.
Listening to the Dark Shadows Radio with your host, Al Warren, only on the ZTalk Radio Network.
The Dark Shadows. I'm your host, Al Warren. Tonight we have the Haunted House Diaries with author William J. Hall. Right after these words.
So many years on TV, people recognize me as the guy to call when they think their house is haunted. But people also call me at Roto-Rooter Plumbing and Drain Service. Everyone knows Roto-Rooter is the company to call for clogged sewers and drains, but we can fix any plumbing problem. And now, water damage too. So next time you hear pipes rattling in your walls, your toilet flushed at 2 a.m., don't call a ghost hunter. Call Roto-Rooter.
Call Roto-Rooter, that's the name.
And away go troubles down the drain.
Roto-Rooter.
You can listen to us anytime, anywhere now. Download our free app now for the iPhone and iPad. Look for the Warren Exchange or House of Mystery app at the Apple App Store today.
I'm really psyched Subway's bringing the flavor with this new guacamole for a couple of reasons. First, people really love our guacamole. Rich and creamy, made from Haas avocados and just a hint of jalapeno to keep it interesting. The other reason is, it's just really fun to say. Guacamole.
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 See?
Come in and try our new guacamole on sandwiches like the Chipotle Chicken Melt and discover how it turns up the flavor on all your favorite sandwiches.
Subway. Eat fresh.
Get out of here.
chicken bone here. I'm the boss. Need the info.
And we are back. William J. Hall is joining us again. How are you tonight, sir?
I'm great. Thanks for having me back.
Oh, it's a pleasure. You're great conversation. Always good to talk to. You've written another book. It's out, The Haunted House Diaries. Excellent read. And
thank you.
Let's start with the inspiration, because your first book was excellent as well. And
how did you
get two books so close together, kind of in the same category, but they're both done so well?
Well, thank you again. I like this. Why don't you just go on and on?
Okay,
and
yeah.
Compliment me for the rest of the hour, and I'll just sit here and listen.
No. Yeah.
Now, this was really a lucky find. Paulino, who I became close friends with, he was a witness in the Lindley Street Bridgeport poltergeist case that was a subject of the World's Most Haunted House book. We became quite close, and I was seeing him often, and we discussed a lot of stuff. And it came a point when he said, I got a case in your neck of the woods, and I think you'd be perfect to, meet the family and whatnot. Would you like to come? And, of course, I said, well, yeah, I would. And he said it was one of the strangest, probably the strangest case that he had in 45 years of paranormal research, that it was like a paranormal circus, he called it, or crossroads. So I said, well, geez, that sounds, great.
Yeah.
And so he talked to the family. And so I had a very easy in, because he was researching this since 2005. So, I really dispense with a lot of the first interview kind of stuff you'd go through and the vetting and, all of that. It was already underwritten, if you will, by Paul. And, and he knew an experienced phenomena there. So I knew it was real. I knew the family was the real deal. I knew the history. There was already video evidence, as well as photo evidence. So it was just a great, place to come into it. And we were walking down in the backyard, which is very beautiful and big. And and he said, this could be your second book. And I said, are you sure you don't want to write about it? He said, well, I'll never get to it. So I said, yeah, I would love to. Because the publisher had asked me, what do you want to do next? Which, how do you turn down something like that, when somebody actually wants you to write something? So it was a really great opportunity, from a great friend. And it was good having, brought a team together really to help with it. And it was a great experience, because the family was, they weren't in any turmoil or anything like that. So it wasn't that kind of a thing. It was something where you can relax and visit and sleep over and gather evidence and interview and things like that. And everyone is, very well adjusted and curious and things like that. So it's a great, really great environment to be in and get involved in.
Well, that's great. It helps the process.
Right. Yeah.
And so this was another case that Ed and Lorraine Warren had investigated. Seems to be a lot of that kind of approaching the media lately and movies and things like that. But was that really something that was important to you?
What, that Ed and Lorraine were there?
Yeah, like did that make a difference? Does that like
No, not at all.
Yeah.
No, they stopped by and Lorraine said the house is very full, which, again, is the same impression that we all got. And basically told Donna, the lady of the house, that she really shouldn't worry. They didn't see any, harm or issues that way. And they left. So did it make a nice addition to the book? Yeah, but it's, with or without them, it wouldn't have really mattered. And in fact, it really didn't give any insight to what was going on there. I think we needed the people I brought in and people who were, broader minded, for lack of a better term, Ed and Lorraine, nice people. You know, I think they meant well, but, you know, very old school. And, you know, everything they experienced was tied to their beliefs. You know, I mean, we're all kind of, you know, guilty of that, but I try to keep an open mind and, you know, say, hey, it could be one of these five things, or it might be something else that's not on my list, that kind of thing. But, you know, they were very much everything's a demon or a spirit of the dead, or, you know, it was very compartmentalized and, you know, old school. And, you know, that's okay, because that, you know, that was their belief, just like, you know, the old time parapsychologist. And, you know, some of us still do believe about the agent of the poltergeist and all that. And, you know, I like to think broader, not that that's necessarily, I mean, that may be part of it or all of it, who knows. But, but yeah, so it didn't matter that they were involved. I mean, it was nice to have, you know, that as part of the story, but, you know, again, not a significant part at all.
Did you find when you have cases like this and you're going to perhaps write about it, that do you look for outside kind of, how do you say, outside support like that, such as Ed and Lorraine, maybe not them, but in your own circle somehow? Do you have particular people you like to work with on these?
Yeah. I mean, Paul, of course, would be one of them. He's just a, you know, great guy, great friend. Shane Sarway, who is, I call him the trifecta of the paranormal. He grew up in a haunted house. He had a near-death experience, and he's Native American. So if he's not sensitive to anything, then, yeah, there's nothing there. And, you know, Mark D'Antonio is great to have. He's an astrophysicist. He's also an audiovisual expert for the Mutual UFO Network. And it was great having him on board because, you know, yeah, I'm a magician, but I don't know about optics. You know, see, you know, there wasn't an issue with, you know, the family faking things, or, you know, there wasn't any of those issues. But misinterpretation and perception are always, you know, they always need to be in the forefront of our minds. And Mark was, as we call them, our resident buzzkill. I mean, he, you know, talk about somebody who's, he's open-minded. He's had paranormal experiences himself. Obviously, he believes in UFOs because he's, you know, with the Mutual UFO Network. So he's done all this stuff, and he has all of this personal experience because he was also a contributor to book. He had a missing time and an implant and all sorts of stuff, which we can get to later. But he had his own experiences, in that very area. But if you tell him something's phenomena, he will still try to dispel it. And I think that's just a great thing, because you have to – you have to do that. You have to be objective. You have to realize that you're going to be subject to the same optical illusions in photos that you would be at a place that isn't haunted. And, you know, if you know a place has phenomena and you're taking photos, it's only natural to see anything in those photos as evidence of that phenomena. And it may be or it may not be. So, you know, you really can't do it. You know, I'm a big proponent of, you know, bring the people in that know. You know, if somebody's getting cuts on their arms, you know, you better have a psychologist on hand. You know, if somebody's telling fortunes, you better get a magician. If somebody's showing you photos, you better have a photo analyst. And if you don't, you're going to get fooled unintentionally. I mean, everybody, it's not like people are trying to fake things, but it's only natural for us all to, you know, to see the evidence that we're looking for, especially if we know we're in a place that has phenomena. So I'm a big proponent, as I think all of the, not that I'm a great one, but as all the great paranormal investigators do, is they're more or less, you know, the leader of a team that brings in the necessary experts to get the job done. You know, I don't think a lay person could interpret the validity of a fortune teller without a magician. It's just not possible. It's not within your bailiwick. It's not. It's like me looking at the engine of a car and telling you what it looks like. I don't know anything about cars, so my opinion's useless. And the same would be about a lay person with fortune telling. It also would be the same result of me looking at a photo, because what do I know about? I mean, I know more now working with Mark, but you know, I'm not an optical expert, so I, you know, I'll miss some things that are reflections and think that they're something else, or maybe not, but, or maybe simply not know. So I think it's a very, very important step to bring in the right people, because the worst thing, the thing I want to avoid is I don't want to put a photo in my book that's obviously, you know, just an optical illusion.
Right. Right. You know. Yeah. You want to have some sort of, yeah, I agree. And in the research and the timing that you're doing all this, how does this affect your personal life? Just on that side of it? Like, do you put 24/7 into this?
No, I pick away at it. You know, certainly you put a lot of time into it. And I was able to do, you know, with this, of course, it was very different because it was an active investigation. So I was writing as well as being on site, you know, at the same time. So it was a bit more involved, but, you know, but luckily, you know, I haven't found a girlfriend yet, so I'm so I have the time.
Yeah, because that would have, it would have been twice as long. Easy.
It would have been twice as long, right? Yeah, yeah. No, but it was, it was, of course, a labor of love, and you know, and it was very social. This book, as opposed to, you know, to Lindley Street, which was a wonderful experience, but it was finding a treasure trove of interview tapes and things like, and doing a lot of interviews, things like that. This was a lot of on-site. So it was, you know, it had a nice social component to it. You know, the family's wonderful and lovely, and it was great getting to know them, and they adopted me despite the fact that they didn't want to, but I forced them. But, and you know, so it was just a great, you know, like I said, a great social experience to boot. But of course, that did make it more of a challenge because you had to write and you had to make sure that you were on site gathering the things that you need and the interviews that you need and things like that. So,
well, that's interesting. But did you find that a different way on your writing? Because as in, like you said, the first book on Lindley Street, you did a lot more research and less, it's not like you're, now this one here, you're doing a lot of in-house, you're there. Is that a different approach in your writing then?
Yeah, I would say it would be. Like, you know, for the diary, there was the original diary, and then, you know, the way it happened for the book is I would interview individually different members of the family and see where we can add to the detail, the diary, the questions that I had that I think readers would have. Because when you're just writing notes, you know, you're not writing it as detailed. And so I wanted to make sure, you know, that we got all the details within those entries, you know, especially if it's something Donna half saw, but somebody else may have seen altogether. And to also get their reactions to it. So, you know, if there were any notes that I can make about reflections and things like that. So that was one difference. And, you know, the other thing was having, an active investigation section of the book as opposed to, you know, recounting an investigation that took place back in the 70s. So, yeah, there were some, differences to it in that respect. And yeah, it was very neat because, of course, I experienced things and was part of that evidence gathering. And, you know, I really enjoyed that, you know, which, of course, was not available with Lindley Street other than the amazing amount of things that were on the, you know, the cassettes and reel to reel. But, you know.
Right. And if I remember right now, when you grew up, you were a practicing magician. And now your father was not really a believer of the things in Lindley House and paranormal ghosts and that sort of thing. That's if I remember right.
Oh, yeah, no, you do. Yeah, a load of crap, I think, was his exact.
Yeah, I think that was the.
Yeah. Although it's amazing listening to me and, you know, the evidence I gathered in the first, in the book, he's not putting it down as much. It seems to be like it's opened up a little for him. You know, he's not a big reader and whatnot. So, you know, he's actually, God bless him, he's tried to read it, but he doesn't get, but yeah, he's just not a reader.
Yeah.
Or especially, you know, at you know, his retirement age. But he is a bit more open to it, and I think that he is intrigued. Maybe still doesn't, but he's intrigued. He's at a level of intriguement versus his original, it's all crap and I don't want to hear any details because my mind's made up. And, you know, like Stan Friedman says, my mind's made up. Don't bother me with the facts, you know. So he has been surprisingly more open to it. So,
well, that's a good thing. So coming from that background now, so with kind of a non-believing and kind of going into the most haunted house in the world, and now, so has this new experience in writing the diaries and you being more live while things are happening, do you have more of a belief now for it than you did?
Yes. I would say so. I mean, I believe that Lindley Street was real, or else I wouldn't have, you know, written it. But it is that 1%, you know, if you're 99% sure, because how could you be 100 if you didn't? Although, you know, I've said before, sometimes maybe not seeing it is more reliable than seeing it. You know, is it better to have 126 witnesses or me see it and then doubt what I've seen? So, you know, so you can go either way. But no, this was definitely a nice component to it, to say, you know, without a doubt, you know, I know, that it's real. And of course, I've always believed in UFOs. So I get, to me, they're all kind of, you know, related in a sense. You know, I think it's much more holistic than a silo, but it still was a nice confirmation of, even if it's confirmation of what I already knew, it's, you know, there's nothing like, you know, real confirmation. So, so it definitely had a nice dimension to it.
Yeah. I would think that it would change in the way you do things from actually being part of it.
Yes, definitely. Yeah, definitely.
So let's tell the listeners who are going to go out and buy the book now some of the details. What happened?
Well, Donna, it's a paranormal flap, which basically is just an area of heightened energy, an open portal, open window, you know, whatever you want to call it. And it seems to be a triangular area. And I would say this farmhouse, for lack of better terms, is at the epicenter of it. It's surrounded by water on three sides. It's a 1793 farmhouse. So it certainly has had the people go through it. And Donna, the lady of the house, has kept a diary for 50 years. Not every single day, but, you know, has basically written on piece of paper, backs of envelopes, school papers, trying to capture the phenomena that's happened in the house over the years since she was a teenager till now, and she's in her 60s now. And her family has lived in the house for six generations. And as far back as anybody can remember, there's been phenomena in the house. So a good part of the book focuses on her diary and the experiences in the house over the years. And then the next section is about phenomena in the area, because there are many houses in that area that have paranormal phenomena, not to the degree and diversity, et cetera, that, you know, this farmhouse has. But they certainly, there's just a lot of that stuff going on, including in the area many UFO sightings, black helicopter sightings, what we believe is a secret government base, underground government base, Bigfoot sightings. So there's just, it's kind of, as Paul said, a paranormal circus, or like I like to describe it, a one-stop shopping for the paranormal. You know, if you want to experience it. Yeah, it's great because anytime you want, you can go over to this house and, you know, as Ben Eno, Paul's son, said, you know, every time you go there, there's something different. So it's kind of like a great, you know, great place to go and gather evidence and experience things. And so that's basically, you know, the overview part. And then as far as things happening in the house, there are ancestors that interact. There are entities that sometimes interact, sometimes don't, you know, as these things go. There's things that resemble UFO phenomena. There's weird time slips, I would say, for lack of a better term. The children talking like in an adult, kind of very sophisticated voice, and talking about, you know, prior lives and things. Really bizarre things that happen. I can give you, you know, one of my favorite stories is ever since the grandson was at the house, he would point up at the ceiling you know, like he was engaged with something. And you know, they'd have to literally pick him up and, you know, bring him back to the center of the room. And this happened even, you know, when he was in his crib. It was like he was, you know, laughing, like he was, you know, his attention was drawn to some spot in the distance, you know. And he, you know, by a year and a half, he was, you know, he would be playing on the floor, and then he would toddle over and point, and, you know, like he was engaged with something, and smile and things like that. And as he grew a bit older, he would stand, you know, at the window looking out to a very large old tree that stood in the front lawn, and he would say things like, "That's where Ashwar is," you know. So now, of course, they knew there was paranormal stuff going on. They didn't really want to feed this interaction, so they, you know, they just try to distract them with toys and things. And by the time he reached five, it was a fact for him. You know, this was Ashwar, and Ashwar was a little girl in a blue dress, and she got in a car accident with her mother, and she was now stuck here to observe in the tree. And he would actually go out there and put toys around the tree. And they said, "What are you doing?" He said, "Well, I'm putting toys out for Ashwan." And, you know, so it was really a bizarre thing. So, you know, he had mentioned at dinner, Ashwar is searching for her mother. She doesn't know where she is. And Paulino was there in 2010. And he was talking to the grandson and asked about Ashwar, and, you know, the grandson was explaining about Ashwar. And, you know, he even said, you know, a few years ago, she and her mother were driving a silver, this is bizarre, you know, for a little kid to be saying this, a silver two-door Oldsmobile on a country road when an animal darted out in front of them. And Ashwar's mother swerved, hit a tree, splitting the car in two. The fire department was on the scene of the accident. There was gas all over. Now, scene of the accident is like a bizarre term, too, for a young child to say. You know, yeah, the fire department went to the scene. There was gas all over the road. Ashwar was hurt really bad, had blood all over her face. Her left arm was broken. And she immediately went up into the tree. And they had to cut the top of the car off. Her mother was taken to the hospital and died about 2 hours later. So this is, you know, a bizarre story. And so Paul's, you know, asking about this in 2005, and he says, "Well, is Ashwar here now?" And Dale says, "Yeah," and points out the window. "Yeah, she's right up in the tree." So he goes out with his infrared camera, and he films. It's pitch black. He doesn't see anything. And when he got back to his house, he, you know, he checked the video, and during the replay, it was like a serpent-like creature slithering down the tree. And it, you know, was bizarre. And it turns out we found a gentleman, Greg Harold, who back in 1974, he was having trouble with vandals at his home in Florida. And he set up a surveillance camera to try to catch the culprit. And instead, he started catching these entities, which looked like Ashwar. That's bizarre. You know, large head, short arm, tentacles of some sort. And so he was filming the creatures from 1974 to 1980. And so, you know, I sent him the video, and he said, "Oh, yeah, these are the same things that I've been filming." And so he sent me an hour and a half of a video of these things. So I interviewed him for the book and, you know, what he's observed over that time, because he's been, looking, watching these things, trying to figure out the behavior and things like that. And so it's fascinating to think that these Ashwar creatures were filmed, over there in Florida. So, I mean, that's just an example of some of the just crazy things that, have gone on in the house.
Well, and how did the family deal with it? Because this isn't your normal family life, and with so many...
Right.
Well, and so many things happening, not just, little noises or candles blowing out or something like this. These are kind of much bigger events. How did they interact? Did they keep it quiet from family and other people out their close network of friends, or did they try to hide it?
Great question. Donna talks a lot in the diary. I mean, her parents were petrified of course, a different age. They didn't want anybody to know about anything because they felt if they went to sell the house, they wouldn't be able to. Of course, nowadays they might be able to get more money for it. Who knows?
Yeah.
But Donna, she was born at the hospital and brought back to this house. So to her, the paranormal was normal. The only time that she realized it was different in her situation was when she had sleepovers with her friends and realized how quiet it was at their houses. Because otherwise, as a child, you don't know, right? You think everybody has this kind of experience. So, growing up that way, Donna was not, quote unquote, afraid. I think a lot of people who would be in that house would leave. But Donna grew up with it, and she sees it for what it is, and so does the family. Now, different people react differently. Her son says, "Oh, no way I'd live back in that house." And, her daughter would live in the house but wouldn't want to go in the basement alone. So, I mean, everybody has their level of that kind of thing. Luckily, for the most part, there hasn't been, intense negative kind of activity, but that's the kind of people they are. I mean, right now Donna and her husband Bob live in the house. And, they're not scared to death. I mean, if they were, they certainly would leave. I mean, they know the stuff happens and, the house has been in the family for generations and Donna's not, it's not like she's afraid for her life or anything. If the drapes jump off or something, yeah, she'll jump just like I would if a loud noise or something fell over. The actual phenomena itself, she says, well, a lot of it's over very quick, so it wouldn't scare you. Plus, she's not the type, she doesn't hear footsteps and yell demon. You know what I mean? She's not that kind of a person. So I think they're the perfect people to have there. Obviously, if you had a, dysfunctional family or something in there, it could be a nightmare because, of course, then you get other things coming through the portal, if you will. And of course, not just peeking through, but, of course, knowing that there's something there to feed on or, at least that's what it's appeared that they do. How they handle... Now, that doesn't mean they weren't concerned, like, oh, geez, what is Dale involved with?
Yeah.
And, of course, some people, who read this stuff and either my book or other books would say, well, how could they put their children in danger? But I think their understanding of the paranormal is much different. So I don't think they have that same, Donna's children, both Michelle and her grandchild, Dale, they were entertained by these things. And she believed, in the case of Michelle, that, she was being entertained by a deceased loved one who later Michelle was able to identify, never saw before, and said, oh, yeah, he used to play with me in my crib. And they're like, what? how do you say, why do you say that? You can't know that,
Yeah.
I think it really is the interpretation. If you interpret it all as evil and demons, then, yeah, it's irresponsible. They should be frightened. They should run, But that's really, a bang in the wall to them was some sort of paranormal activity, but they didn't look at a bang of a wall as being evil. They looked at it as a bang in the wall, So I think it's just a very different thing. Now, that doesn't mean that maybe I would stay there. Maybe I would, maybe I wouldn't, it's hard to say what you do if you're not in the situation, But I think, you know, for somebody like Donna, I think it would take something. I mean, again, she grew up with it, so it's a bit different. And plus, she's got, you know, they got a really good understanding of it, you know, and I think the way you understand it and the way you interpret it makes a big difference. Because, I mean, people ask me, well, were you scared going there? And I said, not at all. And not because I'm brave, just because I think I had the right people around me that explain the way these things worked. And as I learned that, it wasn't scary because I understood the limitations. I understood, you know, again, these things can't do anything to you. Sure, they can ruin your life.
Yeah.
But that's only if you let them, kind of thing. You know, it's not that psychological ruin is harmless. No, it's not. It's probably the worst. But as long as you understand, I think, how it behaves and, you know, why and what it means and that kind of thing, you know, I think that gives you a big edge. Obviously, if you're frightened and you're tormented and horrified, then it's not going to be good, just like any stress in our life that we put on ourselves when there's no reason to. So,
yeah. And you were saying, like, this is sort of in this area, there was a lot of paranormal activity, I guess is the best we could put it.
Yeah.
So I guess kind of the neighbors and the people around them were all sort of, I don't want to say used to it, but they're familiar with all the happenings.
Yes. Not necessarily, you know, I mean, Donna shared it with some people. Of course, now the book's out, so, you know, a lot of people know. Before that, it would be more of a kind of testing, like bringing the subject to haunted houses and kind of seeing, you know, what they say and stuff. But she knows, you know, some of the neighbors have, you know, activity and that kind of thing. And there's actually, you know, a decent amount in the area that has activity, not, again, to the degree they do. I mean, their kitchen was a general store. So, I mean, and of course, 1793. So, you know, the amount of people that have gone through that place, as well as being at the center of kind of that surrounded by water on three sides and, you know, just everything. It's like a paranormal poster child, that land there. So, but yeah. And of course, a lot of the people, you know, there's a lot of UFO sightings there. There was, you know, I didn't speak of in the book, but there was allegedly a UFO craft there. That was not true. So, you know, just to mention that, I didn't mention in the book that it wasn't true, but I didn't mention in the book at all. But that was actually a meteor that looked like it crashed, but it didn't. It really went over the horizon. So it was, you know, one of those kinds of things. So, you know, again, the importance of, you know, validating and looking at the right, you know, the right place. And of course, that's unfortunately kind of, you know, why a lot of people look at us people who believe in the paranormal and they're like, you guys are idiots. And, you know, that's not true.
Yeah.
But you really do need to validate this stuff. Actually, I've had the other reaction. I know I was always not scared, but I always wondered putting my name on it, being a magician and, you know, and also, you know, interacting with people, whether they would think it's weird. But I'm absolutely very surprised that I don't remember coming across anyone who, maybe it's just people I hang out with. No, because even strangers, I don't remember coming across anybody that really said, no, you know, don't believe in the paranormal at all. I mean, I'm sure there are people out there, but it looked like everybody knew somebody or had a story or definitely believed for a number of reasons. And it was kind of like, you know, 6 degrees Kevin Bacon or, you know, whatever person you want to use. But yeah, I mean, it was, and people in my family, even, you know, cousins and stuff that I, you know, never talked to the paranormal about. And once you have a book out with that and they come and confide stuff with you that you're like, well, how come you didn't tell me? And they're like, well, you don't tell your magician. Why would we tell you? You know, it's like, you know, be scared, you know, talk about a more scary person to, you know, talk to about it.
Well, yeah.
So, yeah, so it's, and you probably find that too. It really is amazing, you know.
Yeah, there's people in the closet. Yeah.
Right, exactly. And, you know, people think, well, if it's that prevalent, how come, you know, it's like, yeah, but if you look around, it you know, don't say how come only a few people, because it really isn't a few people. It's in my journey, it's almost everybody. It's like,
I see it all the time, and it is like being in the closet. There's a lot of people that are scared, and they think that, I guess they think people will laugh at them, or there's all sorts of issues, I guess, that can come up, and I find it different in different areas. There's one about ghosts and ghost hunting. It seems to be a little bit better now than, let's say, still UFOs.
Right. I see what you mean. Yeah. Also, professionals, of course. You know, if you're a psychologist and you've run into this stuff or have patients who have and really believe them, you can't get behind it on record, so to speak. You know.
Right. Yeah.
It's a tough thing.
Yeah, it's a tough. And people, I think there's the typical, there's a stereotype to the type of person that would believe in this sort of thing, and they're going to rope you in there. So
yeah, it definitely is getting better, though, you know, with physics and, you know, quantum physics and multiple universes and, you know, I thought I'd be more excited when they said water on Mars, but now I'm like, what about Roswell?
You know, what about the important stuff?
Right, exactly. Yeah, they're already here. What do you mean?
Who cares? Yeah, Mars.
I know, it's funny.
Yeah. And so this area, do you think that there's certain parts of the world, speaking of the physics and that are just those sections that will always be a portal? It doesn't matter if the farm exists and what exists in that land and that area, that all these things happen, it will still happen because of the area. It is nothing to do with who's there.
Yes, no, I completely agree. It's definitely not the house, it's the land. Obviously the house has people in it, and because that area itself has this phenomena, the people are on that land, so that's of course where it ties in. But yeah, it definitely is the land and not just a house kind of deal. And Donna can vouch for six generations of family, and there's only been three different families that have lived in this house, which is amazing. So, you know, her family line goes back six generations, and they've always talked about, you know, paranormal stuff going on there. And there's been, you know, Bigfoot sightings and, people from the sky talking to the people on Earth. You know, those kind of legends go back, you know, Mohawk Mountain in the area, you know, literally hundreds of years. So, I mean, we're talking about a place that's just has a long, long history of this. Will it always be a portal? You know, who knows? But I would say there's a good chance of it.
Yeah.
You know, kind of like Bermuda Triangle and, you know, and those other kind of things. I don't know if the Hudson Valley area is still like that. From Hudson Valley UFOs, another, of course, famous flap, Bridgewater Triangle, and, you know, Skinwalker Ranch, and, you know, all those kind of. Matter of fact, Paul called this the Connecticut Skinwalker Ranch because it had the same kind of diversity, you know, although, you know, luckily it's more fascinating than, there was some negative stuff, but not really, or things that you can interpret as negative. I'd rather say it that way because, you know, a lot of stuff we interpret negative, but they may have negative effects on us, but maybe they're not negative themselves. You know, like, it's funny, I was giving a lecture the other day and somebody said some people felt sick, so they, you know, the Paranormal Society said, well, that's negative energy. And I thought to myself, well, why does it have to be negative energy? You know, why can't it just be energy that made you feel sick? You know, maybe the outcome's negative to you.
Yeah.
But doesn't mean the energy's negative. That's it could be, you know, if you have a parallel world intersect, or, you know, like in Lindley Street with the refrigerator floating, I mean, that's due to the energy. So there would be valid reason why you wouldn't feel very good being in the middle of that.
Yeah. Yeah.
So.
Oh, totally. I mean, it's just like music or anything. It would be like saying that's a negative song, even though it made you feel sick or you hate that song and the next person loves it.
It's a good analogy.
Well, the best I can do.
Yeah. But that's why I think, you know, we're quick to say negative or evil or that kind of thing. But the outcome could be very negative. You feel sick. That's not a great feeling, but it doesn't mean that it was caused by something bad. It's right. caused by something that's bad for you, for yeah. your health or for, you know, the way you feel. But it doesn't mean that the energy itself is bad. It could just be energy.
Right, yeah, so. Right. The pumpkin spice latte, and that's what happened.
Exactly.
Oh, I'm terrible here. So now, what was your impression when you were there? So you said that you were there because you had a group of people that were comfortable and knew the situation. Were there things that scared you?
No, I wasn't scared at all. And I think, you know, of course, part of that was I was writing a book, so I was more excited to gather things. So, you know, we'd set up the cameras that would, you know, respond to movement and take three consecutive pictures that were timed and, you know, the audio and that stuff. So I was very excited about gathering things. I went in the basement myself, which is, you know, kind of a creepy place. But no, I wasn't. But, you know, again, I think that wasn't because I was brave. I think it's because I think I had learned enough where, you know, I truly understood. If I didn't understand what it was, I probably would have been in the mindset of, you know, the exorcists and demons and, you know, and evil and, you know, or not knowing what or how these things behave. And, you know, then it can be quite scary because now you're left to, of course, the unknown. But I think, not that we know everything about this stuff, obviously, but we do know about, you know, the way a lot of it behaves and things like that. And I wasn't scared at all. Of course, like I said, I was writing a book, so I was anxious to get stuff for the book. So,
yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, what if you were alone? If you would have went to the house there all by yourself at the very beginning and without any real support team, you could just bring one person with you, you go to the house and spend a day or two. Do you think it would have been a different situation for you? Would you have been a little more scared?
Maybe at night I would be.
Yeah.
I'm pretty good at freaking myself out, but yeah, yeah, you know, maybe at night. Although it's funny because the first night we did a sleepover and Shane was there and I fell like right to sleep. I mean, I fell right to sleep and woke up in the morning and I was trying to stay up with him. I just fell right to sleep and he's like, man, I'm surprised you didn't wake up. There's these noises and then, you know, so I'm like, yeah, I get it. Evidently I'm not scared of anything other than losing sleep. So, you know,
yeah.
But yeah, I think if it was just me all alone,
Yeah,
I don't think I would be shivering, but certainly you'd be a little more paranoid or, you know.
Yeah, you'd be more.
Yeah, I'd still be pretty good. But again, I would be, you know, I might be 20% scared even if I didn't believe in ghosts at all.
So you didn't really get the impression it was an evil place overall. Like I'm not into the demon scenario, but I just like,
right.
But you're not getting a place that it was kind of, you know, just dark feeling and kind of real down.
No, not at all. Even when I had, you know, the experience in the basement where I felt like there was hundreds of people there, I didn't feel like they were bad people or good people. Just, you know, that it was very, actually very similar to what Lorraine Warren said, which was, you know, the house is full.
Yeah.
And Paul had the same experience in the same spot I did. Paul and Ben did at a different time, which is interesting because we didn't talk to each other, but Donna had mentioned it to me and she said, I said, Donna, do you feel anything here? And she said, no, I never felt anything here. But it's funny you say that because Paul and Ben almost said the exact same thing you did. So I thought that was weird. And then, you know, Shane did test the area, you know, he tested, electrical, making sure there's nothing that would make you feel a little weird there or something. You know, again, you have to try to, even though you know there's phenomena going on in the house, you know, we still have to, of course, make sure that isolate those variables, make sure that that's really what's going on. with that particular experience, you know. So,
and in a particular room like that, and when you're saying you feel like there's like lots of people and you're in a crowd, do you feel like they know you're there too? Do you feel part of the group, or do you feel isolated in the group?
No, I felt like they knew I was there. It's funny, nobody asked me that, but now that I'm thinking about it, yeah, I did feel they knew I was there. I don't know if they really did, but I felt like that, maybe just because they felt so close, you know, like they were everywhere. And I know during the experience, there were incidents where people did not interact with us. I mean, like, you know, the general store where you hear horses, and outside you hear horses and then you hear kind of the general store chatter, like customers. Those weren't interacting. But then on the other hand, there's the experience where we keep going in the basement, and suddenly we find, you know, we set up stuff in the basement, went down there 20 minutes later, and now this cabinet door is wide open, like blocking the way to the workshop, which, you know, Shane had said is the most active area. And he said, well, yeah, it's blocking the way because it doesn't want us in here. Not because it's evil, almost because they're kind of scared in a way.
Right.
You know, as Shane explained, they're dealing with our intrusion the same way that we would potentially view themselves as intruding. They're just a little scared. They know we're on to them. You know, and we got cameras and all this stuff set up, so they're like, "Whoa, what's going on here?" You know.
Yeah, they're quick. Hide the drugs.
Exactly. Yeah, right. Yeah, hide the spirit drugs.
Yeah, hide the spirit drugs. Yeah, no, it's just interesting. And do you ever feel like they're trying to connect with you, or they just sort of let you in the group? Or did you feel other people's conversations? Did you feel other people's thoughts?
I did not. Shane did, and probably Paul too. I'm not sensitive at all. So the fact that I felt anything is a miracle. But, you know, who knows? Maybe I'll get it as, you know, the experience goes on. I do know over the years they have. I mean, I remember Donna's daughter. Well, not remember from experience, but from the diaries that, you know, Donna's daughter was sick at one point, and, you know, and she woke up and there was two ladies standing over her, you know, spirits. Saying, oh, you know, she looks sick, you know, what should we do? And, you know, like they're just trying to help out. Yeah. Very, of course, then she got scared and they disappeared. But, so sometimes they do interact. And we had a question and answer, session, in an area that Shane felt somebody. And I asked every question like three times to make sure that, you know, I'm not hearing things and, you know. And we asked first name and then I asked last name, and I got Harry Wilcox, and I didn't know who that was, but, you know, in talking to Donna, Harry was the brother of William, who was the guy who bought that piece of land to build the house on. So that, and he actually lived in the house, you know, at one time. So I thought that was fascinating. To me, that was pretty, you know, that was pretty good. So we did have interactions of that nature, and we also heard them kind of interacting amongst themselves. So again, you know, sometimes there's interaction, and other times, of course, they're going about their business, not really caring. Like in the case of, you know, the general store stuff, it's just business as usual, and, you know, they don't care that you're there, or probably don't even know you're there.
In a case like that, how have you kind of assigned that sort of situation? Is it kind of residual and it's repeating itself, or is it something that's actually going on now? They are actually kind of living out a way.
Yeah, I would say, and again, I'm no expert on it, other than that I know that if I'm going to go with the theory of quantum physics, which I think is probably the best theory right now, again, still highly speculative, long way to go, I would say they're doing it now, that it's not residual. And I know that, you know, from the literature, there's a lot of residual kind of stuff, or, you know, things considered residual that can be disturbed and And then there could be, you know, real-time interactions or real-time continuation. So, you know, I think, I'm open to both, but I probably would go with the multiverse, you know, it's actually happening now in some other, you know, the whole time-space is not linear, almost like a time slip.
Right.
Again, I wouldn't bet my life on either theory, but
well,
but you know, right? You know, but if I had to, but I had to guess, I probably would. The residual thing, I think, is an interesting theory, but it seems a little bit weird, you know.
Well, yeah.
You know, I'm also not a big proponent of, you know, you're dead and you got lost. You know, I don't
right.
know. I have a problem with that one. I think, especially since most of the people who believe that are fairly religious, which makes you wonder, you know, what kind of show is God running up there?
Yeah.
These people are getting it. And why do they need you to help them over to the other side? That's my big question, is why do they need you? You know, if you're religious, you believe in God, and now these people are lost, why are you helping them? Because if God wants them to be lost, let them be lost and stop interfering.
Yeah.
I don't know. You know, maybe I'm being crass, but I mean, it never quite made sense. It was always kind of like, well, why are they here? And it was very primitive, like, well, I forgot my keys. I got something else I have to do. What I mean? It just seemed very simplistic. And of course, we always want to try to make reasons of these things, but that one never made sense. What do you mean they're lost? I don't know. What do you mean they have unfinished business? That's not fair. It's over, all right?
Go. Yeah, business is
done. Time's up. Yeah,
time's up. Sorry you didn't do it. I ask that question quite often, and you're right, and it's usually on a religious sort of framework, person. And I don't know. I don't think there's an answer to that. That always seems a little strange. It's tough. But
I mean, I hope it's not true, because I'll be one of the ones that are lost, because I'm always getting lost.
Yeah.
I'm always getting lost here, so I could just imagine, you know, throw me a loop in some other dimension.
I'll be walking around for years.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, there you go. That's fun. No, and another thing, now, this is one of the first times I've ever, well, you know, I'm only, you know, small time, but in interviewing the people I have, that now this situation you tie a lot in with the ghosts and UFOs, and we're talking Bigfoot, all sorts of phenomena here. So what do you think, they're all tied together then?
Yes, definitely. I think you know, years ago it was very common, you know, the UFO people don't want to talk to the ghost people because they're stupid, and you know, nobody wants to talk to Bigfoot people because they're out of their minds, and you know, and now I think we're more at a place where we realize that these things can't really be thought of in silos. Certainly you can investigate Bigfoot on its own kind of thing, but I mean, I think the that they are very related, and I think places like this paranormal flap, as well as Skinwalker Ranch and Bridgewater Triangle, you know, all those kind of flaps, lend the question of a more holistic view that these things, you know, they don't necessarily, of course, know all each other, but these things are definitely intersects of some sort, and they may all travel in the same kind of way. You know, maybe UFOs aren't from another planet. Maybe they're from another dimension, another time, you know, that kind of thing. And maybe that's why, you know, Bigfoot's so good at hide and seek, is because, you know, these parallel world intersects. And, I was at a UFO convention last year, and I believe the statistic was something like 83% of the time there's, you know, this UFO stuff, there's haunted houses. And so, you know, we're making these connections more and more. And I think that's a good thing. Just like, many, many years ago, if a house is haunted, you really wouldn't think to look to the other houses. You know, it was kind of known. It wasn't like completely unknown. It would, you know, you'd think of it as like a spillover or something. but you wouldn't be think of it in terms of like a more like a portal kind of thing.
Right.
And I think now we realize that, you know, if you have a haunted house, that you look, and I use that term loosely because sometimes it's the people that are haunted or the land or, you know, et cetera. You know, you look towards the other places, and there probably are more than just that one. Not always, because, of course, it depends on what it is, you know, or, you know, the nature of that kind of haunting. You know, there's different kinds and stuff. But yeah, I think we're really we're more in tune with looking, you know, beyond that. And I think we need to continue to do that. I think that's probably one of the biggest advancements that we've made, you know, because it's so hard to make advancements in this stuff.
Yeah.
And I think the looking at it holistically is definitely one of the bigger, you know, advancements in thought that, you know, that we've made with the phenomena.
Yeah. And so are you a believer that UFOs and aliens are part of our experience with, as we call it, ghosts or spirits? Like one is really... They're really connected, as in, how do I explain that? That a lot of, well, some people believe that the aliens and the UFOs have all been part of the time slip, and it's all part of what we see when we deal with spirits and ghosts.
Oh, I see. I mean, it certainly could be, and you know, that's the big question. I would definitely be very open to. Them being from another place / time, not necessarily another planet, if you will, right. But another, you know, dimension. I would say maybe 50, you go either way, you know, right. I mean, they could be from a different planet, but they've learned to be able to, you know, travel in this way, or maybe it really is, you know, like what you just described. And that certainly is, you know, a theory a lot more people are talking about these days is exactly that, you know, wouldn't that explain how they're, you know, able to come and go and, you know, so fast and so seemingly more advanced than maybe they even need to be, you know, depending on, of course, how this whole travel works, obviously.
Right, right. Something beyond. And so there's... Also, sightings of Bigfoot around the house in the area. Did any of that family itself, like Don and that, see Bigfoots?
You know, it's interesting. They actually did, and they didn't say we saw Bigfoot. They described this as just another paranormal experience. They didn't know what it was. And it was interesting because as I'm interviewing them, I'm like, wow. You know, and I told them afterwards, I said, Did you know that you just described like a classic kind of Bigfoot, you know, set? Because they didn't know. So I thought that was really cool, you know, that they didn't really know what it was per se. It was just a, you know, to them, it was just a cryptid, you know, or a weird, you know, thing. So, and I think, you know, Paulino mentioned a really great way to view this too is to say, you know, we tend to think of, you know, if it's phenomena seen outside, it's more likely UFOs. If it's inside, it's, you know, it's spirits. But, you know, sometimes stuff that happens inside could be UFO related or kind of tracks more with some of the UFO phenomena. So, again, we put things into context based on, you know, the way we see things. So, you know, it's a challenge. You got to continually... you know, make yourself objective and question things. And so, you know, so that's a challenge for us all.
So personally, what was the most, I will say, most memorable experience from you being in the house? Was it the crowd downstairs?
Yeah, I would say it was equally the crowd and you know, the door being open. Because, I mean, nobody was down there. You know, I tried to duplicate it. It's actually held shut magnetically. It was just, that to me was fascinating. I mean, it doesn't seem like a big deal, but, you know, it was, well that, and we did, we captured the head of a little girl in, you know, reflection in the door. And also this thing that went by the front of the house. So now that I think of it, there was there's a few things. But yeah, it was all quite neat. And of course the video that wasn't in the house, but I mean the video that Paul took is absolutely one of the more fascinating things that I've ever seen. Especially having, you know, Mark's D'Antonio's eye on it, and he looked and vet it through the photos here, and I'm good to say that, you know, this photo looks weird. It's either something completely screwed up or this is multiple worlds intersecting kind of thing. You know, I try to leave it open because it's, you know, I don't want to preach to somebody and say this is definitely what it is, because I think the best we can say is this is weird, and I think this very well could be phenomena based on what goes on in the house. But you know, remaining objective is a must.
Yeah. And for Donna, and what was the biggest kind of most interesting story that she told you that you put in the book? So if people buy the book, they'll get an idea of the kind of things that happened to her.
Wow, there's so many,
but it's a
really, yeah, there's so many, but one of them that's very interesting is. When Donna, this back in 1979, Donna, of course, being, I think, a teenager at that time, or very young, but, you know, younger at that time, and her mother opened the mailbox by the front door, and there was a note in it from two old friends, and it said, sorry, we miss you, Betty and Fred. And, you know, she hadn't seen them in nearly 30 years, so she was going to look for their number and call them. And, yeah, the note was written in pencil and kind of very shaky, like the pencil had been pressed down really hard onto the paper. And so she ended up finding the number and called them. They were surprised to hear from her, and they did not stop by, and they didn't leave a note, and they hadn't been in the area for years. And then about a week later, they got a note from two other friends, Ruby and Garnet. It was almost the same kind of writing, you know, sort of shaky, pressed deeply into the paper. And she hadn't seen them in many years, and said she'll call them and have them over for lunch. Before she could even call them, they appear at the door. And so she welcomes them in and says, hey, you know, I got your note. Sorry, we missed you. And they looked at each other puzzled and said, we didn't leave a note. And matter of fact, we just decided to stop by a few minutes ago. You know, they no longer lived in the area, and it was an unplanned stop, just as they were passing through. So that's kind of that time slip thing.
Yeah.
A lot of very fascinating things like that. Hmm. Phone call from an old, sound like a ship, like an old time, ship, emergency. Of course, we've heard about, you know, phone calls from the dead, that kind of thing. So, you know, even a weird phone call she's had. The children talking about, you know, before I was your baby, I was, you know, all of a sudden going on like that in the back seat. And, yeah. Nice wide variety of things, some of which, and, you know, I had some experienced people with me, and some of which they said they never heard of before. So that was cool.
Oh, and at the Donna waking to the time of 1242, and that being the house number. Now, do you find that that's something that... Have you ever researched things like that, like numbers, and why people see them?
Well, the one thing I know, and I think Shane had mentioned it, that... the big question is, you know, is that phenomena or not? And it appeared like it could be, you know, and as Shane pointed out, and I think Paul too, that, you know, it's one of the ways that these things try to get your attention, or, you know, trying to give a message to let you know it's something, someone intelligent behind it, whether it's an ancestor, you know, or whatever it happens to be, an entity. But, you always have to consider, are people just noticing that time because they're making that connection in their heads, knowing everything that goes on in the house. But because it's such a specific time, in this case and the amount of times it occurred, you know, I lean towards phenomena, but, you know, being a healthy skeptic, you know, I think it potentially can go either way, just like with 9/11, people were seeing the number 9/11 everywhere, you know, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, in this case, it's a very specific, you know, it's not like midnight, you know, I mean, I kept waking up at midnight, you know, and then you say, well, yeah, all right, you know. So again, it could be, and I include it all there knowing that a lot of it would be phenomena, and some of it may or may not be, but it's interesting enough, and it's in the right house where it very well could be. You know, like there's an incident where Donna was very ill and almost going to die, and you know, the grandmother said, if I can switch places, you know, I'd give her my life. And then Donna miraculously recovered, and, you know, the grandmother died. And that was in the house. And so, you know, I'm not a conspiracy guy or anything, so you'd say, well, is that really phenomena, or is that just, you know, coincidence or whatever? Well, you know, normally I'd say coincidence, but in this house, I'd say it very well could be something more, you know what I mean? So I think you include all of that, and then, you know,
and kind
there's
of
definitely it. Plenty of real phenomena in there, but, you know, rather than leave it out because you'd say, well, I don't know either way, I'd rather include it because, again, in this house, it would be much more likely to really be phenomena versus just a coincidence. So.
Yeah. Well, I personally was always a skeptic toward the numbers sort of thing, but now that it's happened to me in my life, I'm sort of a little bit more, it gives me thought. You know, I can't just let it go now like the old days. I mean, I understand the idea of you buying a certain car or a certain thing and you see other people with it, so you get an association.
Right, yeah, yeah.
But the numbers, sometimes too precise and too often, so...
Yeah, that was my point about, you know, the numbers very precise. It's not like, oh, I wake up every night at 1 o'clock, and is it really 1 or is it 1:15 or is it, you know, but this is, you know, when you're saying you're waking at a precise time, you know, then it makes you think maybe this is a way that, you know, they call your attention to it, you know, which as, you know, Shane brought up both ways that, you know, could very well be real that, you know, this is how they gain attention, or, you know, or it could be just, you know, noticing it and, you know, but I do trust Donna. And, you know, when she says it's more than that, you know, I trust her because she's big to put down things that are not, she also is very good at looking at stuff that's looking at reasons that are not paranormal. So she's very good at doing that. So if she says, if she's got a good inkling that this is something out of the ordinary, I tend to put a little more trust in it than I normally would just knowing her and, you know, all the things that she's disproved, you know, during this journey. So.
Hmm. Well, certainly amazing. Where do you see, her go? Do you ever see her moving away or?
Well, you know, I know Bob may want to because, you know, it's a big place to heat. So, you know, so, you know, from that point of view, but I think Donna, is proud and loves the home for the fact that it's been in the family for so long. So, you know, I don't know. I could see it going either way to sell if they have to, you know, financial reasons, et cetera, because, you know, big house. But I can also see them staying in it and wanting to pass it on to the family for, of course, the obvious reason it's been in the family for 6 generations and that it is so special because of the phenomena and, you know, of course, you know, they don't believe it's anything harmful either. So.
Right. Wow. Well, fascinating book. Great read.
And, thank you.
Thank you for being on the show. Now, anybody that's listening that would like to, maybe send you, some information or have some questions, how do they do that?
Yeah, everything's on my website, William J. Hall, H-A-L-L, author.com. There's a list of appearances, interviews. You can get an autographed copy of the book directly from me if you'd like. You can send me a note, a question, share something you've experienced. You know, I'd love to hear that, and you know, also could be included in a you know future book, of course. So yeah, that one site should give you everything you need to know, and hopefully you'll enjoy it. And there's some cool stuff there. So
great. Fantastic. Well, thank you for talking again. This is a pleasure, always.
Ah, my pleasure, too. Thank you.
The mission has been completed.
The end!
By George, he's got it! It is the end!
I'll see you.
This has been a production of the Z-Talk Radio Network.
If you're lying to me, I'll be back.